Praise the Lord. Good afternoon, church. How are you? Amen. Can you give me a smile? Praise God. Smile is very precious, isn't it? Sometimes it is very difficult for us to give a smile because, you know, these muscles are basically very much controlled by, you know, a small thing that is in the left side of our chest, right? The heart. Sometimes our heart is so saddened that we cannot move these muscles. You know, it is very difficult for us to, you know, just twist these muscles and give a smile. But let me tell you, you know, when we come before this word speaks to our heart. Amen. This word speaks to our heart and it changes the condition of our heart. Amen. If we believe that our heart is completely saddened or it's completely discouraged or there is no hope in our heart, let this word come into your heart and it will definitely change the condition of your heart. Amen. Amen. Can you say an amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Because when we are coming before this word, as pastor always says, you know, the words that Jesus spoke or the word that we always study are spirit. And spirit gives us life. Right? We are coming in front of a life-giving word. And when we are coming in front of a life-giving word, we should allow this life-giving word to enter our hearts. And we have to believe in it. Amen. Praise God. So as we are going through this series of studies, and that is about the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So we are into the third part of that series. Today we will go into the word again to learn a different realm of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. In the first part, just doing a summary again quickly. First part, what we learned about the ministerial gifts. And we looked into the motivational gifts of the Holy Spirit, right? Last week, we looked into the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit. Which chapter? 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1 to 11. So let us turn our Bibles to the same chapter today. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 11. Amen. So I'm not going to read this again, but you know, we looked into the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit. So there are how many supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit? 9 supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit. And as we looked into the word last week, we categorized it into 3 parts. Okay. So the 9 supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit can be categorized into 3 parts. What is the first part? Revelation gifts of the Holy Spirit. Second is the utterance gifts of the Holy Spirit. Third is the power gifts of the Holy Spirit. Okay. The revelation gifts of the Holy Spirit is something that is revealed to us. Okay. That is revealed to our heart. Praise God. And utterance gifts of the Holy Spirit is something that we say using our mouth. And the power gifts of the Holy Spirit is something that we do. Right. So there are 3 aspects to it. Revelation, saying and doing. Praise God. So at this time, you know, when we are coming to the third part of this series, I am going to go into the first category of the gifts of the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit, and that is the revelation gifts of the Holy Spirit. In the last session, we looked into the first 2 gifts of the Holy Spirit, right? So word of wisdom and word of knowledge is what we looked into. And we took an example from the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8, where we looked, you know, how Saul was converted to Paul and how the word of God came to a disciple in Damascus whose name was Ananias, right? Ananias got a word from the Lord, and the first word that he received was the word of knowledge, okay? So what is the word of knowledge? Word of knowledge is the supernatural revelation of the facts concerning people, places and things that have happened in the past or that is happening in the present. So the word of knowledge gives us a supernatural revelation of the facts that is in the mind of God. Sometimes we don't know what is happening in someone else's life because we are so much into our own life. Right? But there are times when we would get a word of knowledge about someone else. about the things that has happened in his past or that is happening currently. And when we get that word of knowledge from God, that is for a purpose, right? So as we all studied, that these gifts of the Holy Spirit is been given to the church. It is not given to make a particular person famous. It is given for the edification and building up of the whole church, right? So when a gift is being administered, it is administered for the building up of the whole church for the common good. So the word of knowledge is something that reveals the facts. Word of wisdom is something that reveals the purposes and the plan of God that is going to happen in the future, right? And in the same example we saw, Ananias got a word of knowledge that gave him the information that there is a person named Saul from Tarsus who is staying in the house of Judas in the straight street, right? And he saw a vision where a man named Ananias will come and pray for him and his sight will be restored back unto him. So that was the word of knowledge that Ananias received. And Ananias was not ready to believe because it is a supernatural word. And Ananias had heard about this man who was very cruel, and he had come with authority to kill all the Christians who are in Damascus. So he responded to God asking more about it. And then the Lord gave him a word of wisdom saying that I have chosen this man whose name is Saul as my vessel, right? And this is a supernatural revelation that is going to happen in the future. I have chosen him as an instrument for my kingdom. And, you know, he's going to reveal great purposes in the life of Saul, that he, how much he must have to suffer for the sake of God's kingdom. And that was the word of wisdom that Ananias received. And then he moved, and then we know what happened. There was a great conversion where we see Saul getting restored, you know, back with his sight, and he moving ahead being Paul. Okay, so we understood about the word of wisdom and the word of knowledge. Okay, so word of knowledge is about the supernatural facts. Word of wisdom is about the supernatural plans and purposes that are in the mind of God. So now, the third gift that we read in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, let us just read that and then we'll go into that. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 10, where we see, to another miraculous powers, to another prophecy, and to another discerning of spirits. Okay? So the third revelation gift of the Holy Spirit is discerning of spirits. Okay? It is not spirit, but it is spirits. Okay? So, we all know the meaning of the word discerning. Right? Discerning is to know about something that is in reality, even though it is being displayed with a fakeness around it. Right? So there are many things or many people who may be, you know, who may have something, you know, some kind of a behavior in their heart, but they will always hide it with a fakeness that they show in their face. Right? So when we say that I discerned what is in his heart, that means I am able to look into the reality through the fakeness that he is displaying through his face, right? So discernment is an ability to understand the truth even though there is fakeness around it, okay? So this third gift, that third revelation gift of the Holy Spirit is about the discerning of spirits, okay? So first thing that we have to understand is there are different kinds of spirit. Okay? There is not only one spirit. There are different kinds of spirits in the world. Okay? And this gift is about discerning of spirit. Okay? Just like what I mentioned about wisdom and knowledge, right? The gift is word of wisdom. Wisdom is not the gift. The word of wisdom is the supernatural gift of the Holy Spirit. Knowledge is not the gift of the Spirit. The word of knowledge is the supernatural gift of the Holy Spirit. Similarly, discerning is not the gift of the Spirit. Okay? When you say, I have got, someone would say, I have got a great ability of discernment. Right? I can see a person and I can know that, you know, how, what he is. It is not. That is not the gift of the Holy Spirit. Discernment is not the gift of the Holy Spirit. But what is the gift? Discerning of spirits. All right? When we say that discerning of spirits is one of the revelation gift of the Holy Spirit, first thing we have to, you know, understand is, no, it is not talking about the gift of suspicion. Okay? We all suspect someone has deceived us. We will always, next time, approach that person with a great suspicion. Right? So, discerning of spirit is not talking about the gift of suspicion. And it is also not talking about gift of judging. Right? Many times we judge people. So, judgment of people is not the gift. Suspicion is also not the gift of the Holy Spirit that we are talking about. It is about the discerning of spirits. Okay? So, this we have to understand. The next time you'll say, someone would say that, you know, someone will come with suspicion and say, I'm acting in this gift of the Holy Spirit, saying discerning of the spirits. No, suspicion is not one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Judgment is also not one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. We will judge people saying, oh, I'm acting in this gift. Now I can discern. I can act and I will judge this person. Lord's word says that do not judge anyone. Right? So discerning of spirit is about looking into the spiritual realm. Right? Yesterday, Pastor was also talking. There is an unseen world around us. Right? When we are living in this world, we are living as if we are living in a seen world. Right? If with the physical eyes, I can see all of you right now sitting. I can see brothers, I can see sisters, I can see children. Right? But this is the seen world. This is the physical world. But in this physical world, there is also an unseen world that we cannot see with our physical eyes. So when we are living in this seen world, there is also a spiritual unseen world all around us. Amen. Amen. And there is lot of spirits out there in the unseen world that we cannot see from our eyes. If we have to know about those spirits, we have to discern it. And that discerning of spirits is one of the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit that has been given to the church. So when we come to the church, when we are called out, when we are saved, when we accept Jesus as our Savior, when we give our life to Him, right? These gifts of the Holy Spirit is something that is given to the church, right? And it is given for the edification and building up of the church. So the discerning of spirit is something that helps us to look into the spiritual world and discern the different kinds of spirits that are there in that spiritual world. Okay? Okay? You have to understand is there are different kinds of spirits. So let us look into what kind of spirits are there. What kind of spirits are there that we cannot see from our eyes, but with the power of the Holy Spirit, when these gifts are manifested, we can discern those spirits. Okay? So let us look into the Bible, few examples, and we will understand the different kinds of spirits out there so that it will help us to flow in this manifestation of the Holy Spirit. Praise God. Can you say an amen? Amen. So let us look into the first category of spirits that are out there in the unseen world, which we have to discern. Okay? So let us turn our Bibles to John chapter 1. Amen. Let us go into John chapter 1. And in John chapter 1, we all know that John the Baptist, he baptized whom? Jesus Christ. Right? He baptized Jesus Christ. So if you go to John chapter 1 verse 32 2 and 33. We'll read that.
Then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him, except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain, he is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.
So now John is giving the testimony that what happened after he baptized Jesus Christ in River Jordan. So what happened? As he baptized Jesus, Jesus went down into the water, right? And he came up. What happened after that? In verse 32, it says, I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. Amen. John saw the Spirit come down on Jesus as a dove. Dove is what? Dove is a bird. So here, it doesn't mean that he actually saw a dove coming in physical and sitting on Jesus. And that's what we see in many movies out there, right? That was the spiritual sight that John saw. And he had to discern it. So he was working in the gift of discerning of spirit. And what kind of spirit is this? This is the Holy Spirit. Amen. And he saw it in a form of a dove. Right? So next time when you see that I'm not receiving the Holy Spirit, many people say, I'm looking for a dove to come down on me. No. In this age, I mean, that's not how God acts. That was a symbol, right? John was discerning the Spirit that he saw in the form of a dove that came upon Jesus and sat on him and remained on him. Amen. The Holy Spirit coming, and he had to discern it. And this is the first category of the Spirit that is out there in that unseen world. And this is the Holy Spirit. Amen. So this is the Holy Spirit. The first category of the Spirit is the Holy Spirit. So let us go into the second category. The second category, let us turn our Bibles to Luke chapter 22. Amen. And here we see Jesus praying on the Mount of Olives. Right? And let us start reading from verse 42. Yeah.
Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours will, yours be done. An angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him.
Okay, so here, Jesus is praying, and this is the cry that he gave. Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. This is the prayer that Jesus prayed to the Father. And after he prayed this prayer, in verse 43, we see an angel from heaven appeared to him and strengthened him. The second kind of spirit that is out there in the world are good angels. Okay? Okay? Here, when Jesus was in a very stressful situation, we see that, you know, the sweat was flowing out of his body as blood. He was in pain. You know, he was in a forsaken state. And he was praying to the Father, if it is possible, please take away this cup from me. But if it is your will, let your will be done. It is a cry of a son, you know, seeking from his Father. Father, can you save me? But then he's telling, I'm ready to obey your will. If it is your will, let that be done. And after he prayed his Father, there was an angel that appeared unto Jesus, and that angel came and ministered unto Jesus and strengthened him. Amen. As children of God, we have to believe that God has charged his angels to look after us. Amen. Amen. There are many verses in the Bible that says that, you know, the angels of the Lord are always with us. When we are traveling, the angels of the Lord are with us. We cannot see them. You know, right now in this room, with the physical eyes, we cannot see there are angels. But there are angels. And I'm talking about good angels. I'm not talking about that fallen angel. Remember? Satan is a fallen angel. He is also an angel. But this angel that came unto Jesus in that garden, right? He was a good angel and he ministered unto Jesus. And when that angel ministered unto Jesus, what happened? Jesus was strengthened. There is a purpose that God has assigned angels in our lives. And the angels are assigned to strengthen us in our weak situations, right? And we have to discern it. We have to discern, right? We cannot see it with our physical eyes. But just like Jesus, how he discerned, he could see that angel ministering unto him. Amen? He sees. So the second category of this of the spirits that are out there in this world is the good angels. And the second example that we can read is, you know, in the book of Acts. So you will tell that this was with Jesus. But even after Jesus was resurrected and taken up to the heaven, there were incidents where angels visited people in the New Testament. Amen. So my favorite chapter, that is Acts chapter 27, where we see in the life of Paul, when he was taken as a prisoner to the city of Rome in a ship. And then there was a big shipwreck that happened due to a storm, right? And if you read Acts chapter 27, verse 23.
Last night an angel of the Lord, whose I am and whom I serve, stood beside me and said, do not be afraid.
Yes.
Do not be afraid, Paul.
Yes.
You must stand trial before Caesar.
Yes.
And God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you.
So this is another good angel that we saw visiting Paul. Right? The same Paul who was converted from Saul. Right? And this angel came to him and revealed things to him. Right? He said, last night an angel of the Lord to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me and said, do not be afraid, Paul. Okay? So God sent his angels to deliver a word from heaven in our lives. Amen? So this is the second category of the spirit that is out there in the unseen world. But there is thing is you have to discern it. You have to discern it. And discerning of spirit is one of the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen? So if we move in this gift, we will be able to discern the Holy Spirit. We will be able to discern the good angels that are out there in the unseen world. And these good angels are here to minister unto us. Now, when we send our kids to school, you know, pray over them. You know, also teach them to pray and believe that when they are going to school, they are not alone. They may be alone in a classroom, right? They may be alone when we are traveling. But teach them that there are angels that are traveling with them. Amen? Teach them. Teach them. Because once, you know, when they come to a stage where they accept Jesus as a savior and they receive salvation, now they will also be having these gifts of the Holy Spirit being able to manifest in their lives. You know, because we taught them, they will be able to move easily in the discerning of the Spirit and they will be able to see those angels walking with them in their life. Amen? And these are good angels. The angels that come to minister, the angels that come to strengthen the people. Amen? 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 Praise God. And same thing, you know, the angels also carry a word from God. Paul, he was traveling in the ship. Everyone had lost hope. Everyone had lost hope. You know, they had stopped eating. For 14 days, they did not even eat anything. And in that middle of that despairing situation, here is a man of God, apostle of God, who is a prisoner. Who is a prisoner in the eyes of the world. Now he is traveling and he is coming with so much faith. Why? What was the reason of this faith? Because he saw an angel that came from the Lord whom he served. And that angel came to him with a word. And what was the word? And that was the word that God gave Paul, that do not be afraid. You know, in the times of our fearful situation, we have to discern the good angels that God has kept in our lives. And these good angels always come with a message of hope, with a message of faith. If you are going out, no, if you are going in fear, these good angels carry the word of God saying, do not be afraid, my dear child. The same word that came to Paul. Do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand trial before Caesar, and God has graciously given you the lives of all who sail with you. You know, here, this angel is coming. An angel is delivering a word of wisdom. Right? So he discerned the spirit. And based on this gift, discerning of spirit, he is receiving a word of wisdom. Right? The wisdom, supernatural plans of God that is going to happen in future. So all these gifts of the spirit are so much connected. You know, here, because he had the discerning of spirit's gift, he could receive a word of wisdom. Right? Right? And he could know what is kept in the future. And that was the reason that Paul could stand in the middle of the all the people who were in complete fear in that ship and declare, do not be afraid. Amen? Do not be afraid. In the physical eyes, this ship may be sinking. In the physical eyes, the ship may be going through a shipwreck and you may think that you all will die. But I have got a word from my God, because an angel of God appeared unto me. And that angel of God was not seen by Paul with his physical eyes, but he had to discern it. And that angel of the word carried a word of hope. Do not be afraid, Paul. Do not be afraid. You are going to appear before Caesar and to Rome. And this ship is traveling to Rome. You know, the storm will come against it. But you have to stand in front of Caesar in Rome, and have graciously given all the lives of the people who are also sailing with you. You know, if you are a child of God, because of you, there are many who are going to be saved. Amen? Amen? God has kept you in places to save many. You may not realize it with your physical eyes. But there is a greater promise that God has kept through your lives. You may not know why I'm kept in this place. Amen? 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 We may think that what is happening, but God has a purpose, because God wants to save many others through your life. Amen? Amen? Paul had this gift of discerning of spirits. He could discern that good angel carrying the word of hope. And he shared that word of hope that carried a word of wisdom. Even I believe when people would have heard it, they had to believe Paul, because there was no other way. If there was some other way, they would have definitely tried to, you know, judge Paul by saying he has gone mad. We are in the middle of the sea. There is nothing here to save us. We cannot even send SOS out there. And this man is telling that none of you will be dying, because my God appeared and he sent an angel with a word that you are going to appear before Caesar. You know, when we have to administer the word of wisdom, we should be ready to face all this criticism, because word of wisdom is not aligning with the word of this world. Amen? Word of wisdom doesn't align with this word of this world. It comes against it. But if we trust and believe in that word of wisdom, the supernatural purposes and the plans of God will be revealed in our lives. Amen? I mean, I always, you know, remember, I mean, see the life of Elijah. You know, 1 Kings chapter 17, out of nowhere, this man comes up. And he comes up with the word of God. Right? Let us turn 1 Kings chapter 17. The first verse.
Now Elijah the Tishbite.
Yes. 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 Yes.
As the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years.
Yes.
Except at my word.
Yes. Suddenly, out of nowhere, before, you know, 1 Kings 17, you will never hear about this man named Elijah. But he came with the word of God, and he's directly declaring the word of God to Ahab. And this word of God is what? Can you say? What is this? A word of wisdom. Right? He's talking about the future. He got a word of wisdom from God. And when he is declaring the word of wisdom, he is declaring without fear to King Ahab, saying, unless I say,
There won't be any rain on the land till 3 years. And this was a word of wisdom that came in. Right? And in if you read, continue to read 1 Kings chapter 17, you know, if you go to, let us turn to 1 Kings chapter 18. Yeah, sorry. 1 Kings chapter 18. In the very last part, in verse 44. Yeah.
The seventh time the servant reported,
yes,
a cloud as small as man's hand is rising.
Yes.
So Elijah said,
yes,
go and tell Ahab,
yes,
hitch up your chariot,
yes,
and go down before the rain stops you.
Now here, Elijah is now praying for the rain, right? He's praying for the rain in Mount Carmel. And there is a servant with him. And when he was praying, and he was praying with very great perseverance, right? And he was praying for that rain. 7 times he sent his servant to see if some cloud is appearing. 7th time when the servant went out and saw, he came back with a report that there is a small cloud, the shape of a palm of a hand appearing, and that was enough. And then he delivered the word of wisdom and saying, go and tell Ahab that he better run back to Jezreel before this heavy rain stops him. He's talking about the future. Now he delivered the word of wisdom once again. This is a man of God delivering the word of wisdom one after another without fear. He's revealing the supernatural purposes that God has kept in the future. He just saw a small cloud. Looking at a small cloud, if we see a small cloud now, you know, we will never believe that there will be a greater rain. Amen? Amen? But he could say, no, go and tell Ahab. This small cloud is enough for me because I have received this word of wisdom. That go and tell Ahab that he better run to Jezreel, because if he doesn't go faster, the rain is going to stop him, because it is going to be a heavy rain. Amen? Amen. So 1 Kings chapter 17, 18, a fearless man of God. The reason is he was ready to proclaim and believe in the word of wisdom that he received from his Lord. He was ready to believe in the supernatural plans and purposes of God that God had kept through his life. He was able to declare it fearfully. But what happened in 1 Kings chapter 19? Let us go. 1 Kings chapter 19. Yes, verse 2.
So Jezebel, yes, sent a messenger to Elijah to say,
yes,
may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them.
In the second verse of 19, this is not a word of wisdom. This is a word of the world. Jezebel coming back with a threat, saying, you know, may the gods deal with me, be it ever so severely, if by this time tomorrow I do not make your life like that of one of them. Who are the one of them? The prophets that he killed. That means Jezebel is giving a life-threatening message, giving a life-threatening word unto Elijah. So far he was relying on the word of wisdom, and he was declaring and he was moving fearlessly. He could go and kill those prophets as well. You know, there was no fear in his life. But suddenly what happened is 1 Kings chapter 19, there is a word of the world coming against this man of God, saying, I am going to kill you by this time tomorrow. What happened? He now was hearing the word of the world. Elijah was afraid. Elijah was afraid. Because now he is giving more importance to the word of the world. You know, many a times in our life as well, there are going to be so many words that will come in our life from the world. World will threaten us that your future is very dark. You are going to be, you know, in a pathetic situation. They're going to judge our children, saying your children are never going to, you know, prosper in their life. He's not even going to pass in his schools. But there are many words of the world out there. But if we believe in that word of the world, we are going to be in a fearful situation. Amen? Amen? If we are going to believe in that word of the world, just like Elijah, he's a man of God. Prophet. Moving in the great gifts of the Holy Spirit. receiving the word of wisdom, but suddenly he focuses his attention from the word of God to the word of the world, and he becomes afraid and he starts to run. And finally, you know, this is a very great chapter. And finally, you know, if you go and read, you know, Elijah running, and then there is an angel of God, right? Can we read that? Verse number 5, yeah. Yes.
All at once an angel touched him and said, get up and eat.
Yes. All at once. Who touched him? Angel touched him. Saying, get up and eat. Why are you afraid? Good angel. Coming in our fearful situation. We are hiding ourselves. We are not even eating. We are hurting our physical body because of that fear that is in our heart. We are not even able to smile. But in that time, just like Elijah's life, there was an angel that appeared unto him. You know, angel called him, get up, come on, eat. This is good angels in the Old Testament, right? We see how this good angel is ministering unto Elijah. Amen. And he had to discern it. He had to discern it. Amen. But still he was afraid. And he gave many excuses, right? He gave many excuses. Let us go to verse 14. Yeah. Of 19 chapter.
He replied, I have been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty.
Yes, he's telling that I have been very zealous about Lord God Almighty. Yeah.
The Israelites have rejected your covenant.
The Israelites have rejected your covenant, God.
They
have torn down all your altars.
And
they have put all your prophets to death with sword. I am the only one left, God. And now they are trying to kill me too. He's giving excuses to Lord why I am running. You know, they have killed all the prophets. Right? They have broken down all the altars. I am the only one left, Lord. He's giving facts. Okay, he's sharing the fact. And this fact is a human fact. Human facts may not be real all the time. It may not be true all the time. Right? He's sharing this knowledge to God, saying, I am the only one left, God. But what did God respond? You know, if you read verse 18. Yeah.
Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel.
Yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel.
All whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and all those whose mouths have not kissed him.
Elijah is telling that I am the only one left, Lord. Everyone have gone. They have killed everyone. No prophet is left. But what is God giving now? A word of knowledge. You know, sometimes our fear is based on our own knowledge. Right? It's based on our own knowledge. We go through something and we try to speculate. Assume things. Because this is happening, I am the next one who will suffer. It is based on our knowledge. Fear is based on our own knowledge that may not be complete. You know, God gives a word of knowledge to sometimes take us out of that fear. Here, God shared the exact number. Elijah is saying only one. God is saying how much? 7,000. Our one is God 7,000. Amen. 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 I have reserved 7,000 men in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down in to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him. You are not the only one, my dear. And that is the reason you are fearful. There are 7,000. And you are the another one. 7,000 plus one, how much? 7,000? One. He was afraid because he was considering himself only one. I'm one. God said, no, you 7,001. Praise God. Praise God. Angel ministering unto Elijah. Good angel. Trying to strengthen him. Bringing out of the fear. He brought him to a situation where he was able to speak. He was so much fearful, he was not able to speak as well. But while he was speaking about the knowledge that he had. And he was speaking about all his fears. And when he was speaking, God gave a word of knowledge to bring him out of the fear. One, now he is 7,001. Praise God. So this is the second category of the Holy Spirit. Second category of the Spirit. First is the Holy Spirit. Second is the good angels. The third category is the human spirit. Okay? Human spirit. Okay? So let us go into that and understand. John chapter 1. John chapter 1. Verse 47.
When Jesus saw Nathanael approaching,
yes,
he said of him,
yes,
here is a true Israelite,
yes,
in whom there is nothing false.
Here Jesus saw Nathanael approaching to him from far. He said to him, here truly is an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. God was looking into the human spirit that was in Nathanael. He did not meet Nathanael. He did not even talk to him. He only saw him under the fig tree. And here, when Nathanael was approaching him, Jesus could discern. And Jesus could discern the human spirit. And based on that, Jesus is commenting, here is a true Israelite in whom there is no deceit. And this is the human spirit. Amen. This is the human spirit that was in Nathanael, which God discerned. You know, when God created all of us, I always say, we are what? We are spirit. We are spirit. We sometimes say that we are body and our life will end when I am dead. No. God created us as a spirit. Our life is not going to end here in this earth. We are just going through a journey. We are a spirit. We live in a body and we have a soul. We are a spirit. We live in a body. We have a soul. Amen. Amen. When God created Adam and Eve, in their spirit, God's spirit also resided. Amen. In that spirit, because of God's spirit, that spirit had life. But when they sinned, after disobeying the commandment of God, they died. They did not die in body, they died in the spirit. That means what happened was, man was separated from God. The spirit of God that was united with the human spirit moved away. And that spirit became dead. Amen. The spirit had no life, but the spirit was there, but it was dead. Here, God is looking, Jesus is looking into Nathanael, and he could discern his human spirit. And how could he discern the human spirit? Because Nathanael's soul had no deceit in it. Amen? Amen? And Jesus could see and look into his heart and saying, here comes a true Israelite. In him there is no deceit. But he doesn't have a life in the spirit yet because he has not received Jesus. But in him there is no deceit. There are human spirit that is working. Amen. And many a times we have to discern this human spirit, because human spirit can be good just like Nathanael, but human spirit can also be away from God, telling us something that is not from God. Amen. We have to discern the good human spirit, and we have to also discern the human spirit that is not aligned with the word of God. Amen. Amen. So third kind of spirit is what? Human spirit. The fourth kind of spirit out there is the evil spirit. Amen. So let us turn our attention to Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13. And here, verse 10 to 13, we see Jesus healing a crippled woman on the Sabbath, right? And this woman was bent from her back. Amen. Was bent from her back. Sometimes we will think that someone, if he's bent from the back, we will say, okay, your spinal cord may have some problem. There may be some bone issue, or there may be some issue that happened maybe because of an accident. But there can be various reasons why someone can be bent from the back, right? There can be natural reasons as well. If someone fall down from a height and they have affected their spinal cord, they will be bent for some time, right? Until it heals itself. So there can be natural reason for hunchback, right? So here in verse 12, when verse 11, and a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Woman was crippled by what? A spirit. And this spirit is evil, because good spirit will not cripple you. Okay? If a spirit is crippling you, that is definitely an evil spirit. And this woman was suffering because of a spirit for 18 years. She was bent for 18 years because of a spirit. Amen. And when Jesus saw that woman, Jesus discerned that this was caused because of the evil spirit. Amen. Amen. So when we are working, you have to see, when we have to work in the gifts of healing as well, there has to be discerning of spirits. Because there could be various sicknesses that may not be because of a natural reason. There could be various disabilities that may not be because of a natural reason. There could be a spirit involved, and that is the evil spirit. As a child of God, if we know about this discerning of the Spirit's gift, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to flow through us. Unless we know about it, we cannot operate in it. The reason we are studying is not to just increase our knowledge about it, but it is to ensure that we know about these gifts of the Spirit that is kept for the church, because when the time comes, we should allow these spirits to manifest through us. Amen? We should allow it. Unless we know about it, we won't be able to allow it. So that is the reason we are studying here. Jesus looked at the woman, and Jesus could discern the evil spirit that was in her. Amen? And what did Jesus say? When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Jesus was not a physiotherapist. He did not ask him to bend 5 times or move sideways, run around. Jesus saw the woman. He could discern that this crippling was because of the evil spirit. And Jesus spoke his word. "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." I believe the moment he said that, that evil spirit could not remain in that woman. 18 years, that evil spirit reigned in her life, did not allow her to straighten up. But when now she's standing in front of Jesus, the righteousness of God. Righteousness is opposite to any evil sin, right? Jesus coming with his true righteousness, looking unto her, discerned the evil spirit in her. I said, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." And that evil spirit left her and she straightened up. Amen? Amen? The fourth kind of the spirit is an evil spirit. Amen. Sometimes evil spirit, we have to be very careful. Here it was easy, and now we'll see that it is easy because she was crippled. Right? This evil spirit caused harm. Evil spirit caused a disability. But sometimes the evil spirit will come with a lot of deception. Right? Let us go to Acts chapter 16. We have to understand all these things, because evil spirits are from the devil. And the devil is the biggest deceiver. Amen? Acts chapter 16. From verse 16, can we read? Yeah.
"Once when we were going to the place of prayer,
yes,
we were met by a slave girl who had a spirit by which she predicted the future."
So now here Paul, Silas, Luke, everyone is traveling, right? They were going to a place of prayer and they were met by a female slave. Okay, she is a slave. She is a female who had a spirit. What did she have? She had a spirit by which she predicted the future. She had a spirit and she predicted the future. Right? We always love to know our future. If there is someone, you know, who could refer to us that you go there, go to that person, he will predict your future and he gives you the reference saying, you know, I could, you know, experience it. Everyone will love to know their future, what's going to happen. Here, there is a female slave. She had a spirit. And because of that spirit, she is able to predict the future. She earned a great deal of money for her masters. Wherever there are supernatural things happening, there is a lot of money. And this supernatural thing is happening due to a spirit because of which the future is being predicted. People are ready to shed money to know their future. And because she was a slave, she is not earning for herself, but she is earning for her masters. Okay? 17.
The girl followed Paul.
Yes.
And the rest of us. Yes. Shouting, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved.
17, she is following Paul and all his, you know, companions, and she's shouting out, these men are servants of the Most High God who are telling you the way to be saved. Is there any falseness in this? Is it a true statement or a false statement? What is it? It is a true statement. Here a spirit is speaking and that spirit is telling the truth. Paul and Silas, she's acting like a PR agent, public relations agent. You know, just an advertisement. Huh? Oh, these are the Most High servants of God. Right? These are the Most High servants of God. And who are telling you the way to be saved. Come on, everyone. No, here to these people, these are the Most High servants. Spirit is telling the truth. And imagine you in the place of Paul. Right? If someone is telling something about you like this, what would you say? Okay, you become my disciple. Keep on traveling with me. Start ministry. You are the chosen vessel. But what happened? You know, continue to read. Verse 18. Yeah. She kept this up for many days. I don't know how many days. Maybe a month. I don't know. Many days she's traveling and she's just, you know, praising this man of God. You know, attracting people, come. These are the Most High servants. For many days this happened. For many days, Paul did not say anything. But finally, let's see. Finally, Paul becomes so troubled, so annoyed. You know, sometimes truth is always, it should comfort us. Right? Right? Or it should give us peace. Here, Paul is not getting peace. For many days he heard. Finally he is getting so troubled. He is getting so, you know, annoyed. He was working in the discerning of the Spirit's gift. You know, he could discern that even though there is a truth coming out of her mouth, she is not carrying the good spirit in her. She is carrying a evil spirit in her. He became annoyed. And what did he do? And said to the Spirit, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to come out of her. Enough. You thought that you will please us. You thought that you will deceive us by saying all these good things. In the name of Jesus, come out of her. What happened? At that moment, the Spirit left. We have to be very careful. Discerning of the spirits. You know, Spirit will come with every true statement. They will appear to be, you know, preaching the best sermon. We have to act in the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is supernatural. Discerning of spirit. You have to understand it. And just like Paul, who was able to discern. Not because of the physical eyes, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. He could see that it was an evil spirit that was working. And he commanded in the name of Jesus, and come out of her. And she was freed. And what happened, you know? She stopped telling all the future. All her masters become very annoyed because now the source of money is gone. Amen? Amen? Paul worked in the discerning of the Spirit's gift. And it was supernatural. So what are the four categories? First category of the spirits out there. Holy Spirit. Amen. We looked into the life of Jesus when he was baptized. Now John gave the testimony. Holy Spirit descended upon Jesus like a dove. He had to discern it. Amen. We have to discern the Holy Spirit. What is the second category? Good angels. Right? We saw how Jesus was ministered by angels in the time of trouble. We saw how an angel appeared in the life of Paul when he was going through a shipwreck situation. And that angel gave a word of hope, word of faith in the middle of his fear. Amen. We saw an angel appearing in the life of Elijah while he was running with his fear. Get up and eat. Amen. Amen. There are good angels. Third kind of spirit, human spirit. How Jesus looked into Nathanael. Right? And there are various other examples. There are various other examples in their life. You know, we see the case of Simon the sorcerer. Right? Simon the sorcerer, when he saw that mighty miracles were happening, they came, you know, he approached Peter. Peter could discern that your heart is not right. There are good human spirits just like Nathanael with no deceit. There are bad human spirits just like the Simon the sorcerer who had deceit in his heart. His heart was not right. Peter was able to discern that. Right? Peter was able to discern it and identify which is bad, which is good. That is the third category of the human spirit. What is the fourth category? The evil spirit. Evil spirit can cause many diseases. It can cause disabilities. As child of God, we have to act in this gift, discerning of spirit. And understand, you know, while we have to pray, you know, gift of healing, we have to discern what kind of spirit is this that is causing it. Is it a spirit or is it a natural thing? Now, there can be various cases where there will be natural things. And we say, oh, good, let the spirit come out. Healing won't come. We have to discern and then we have to pray. Amen? We have got authority to tell the sickness to go out because Jesus died for our sickness. Right? So there is power. When we pray in the name of Jesus, saying, by the stripes of Jesus, we have been healed, you have been healed, pain be gone, sickness be gone. There are supernatural healings that happen. But there are various sicknesses that are caused because of some evil spirit. We have to talk to that evil spirit. We have to command that evil spirit, just like Jesus commanded. Just like Paul commanded. Amen? They did not pray for that. Jesus commanded, come out of her. They did not pray for, you know, the sickness. Jesus did not pray that the back should be straightened. Get freed. Paul did not pray that this girl should get back to her senses. Just Paul discerned that evil spirit inside of her and said, come out of her. And she was freed. Amen. Amen. So this is the third revelation gift of the Holy Spirit that we looked into. What was the first one? Word of wisdom. Second is the word of knowledge. Third is the discerning of spirits. Four different kinds of spirit. Human spirit, good angels, right? Holy Spirit and evil spirit. Praise God. Praise God. Let us close our eyes. Amen. Hallelujah. Let this word that we have studied stick in our minds, because the reason why we are studying these is so that when the time comes, opportune time comes, we could allow these gifts to manifest in our lives because we know. Sometimes we miss it because we are ignorant about it. And that's how Paul started in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. That brothers and sisters, I don't want you to be uninformed. Hallelujah. Father, let us all be informed about this and pray and desire for it. Hallelujah. Let us desire, because God, you know, he distributes this as he determines. We don't determine. that we should get this gifts of the Holy Spirit. He determines, we desire, hallelujah. Let us desire for the discerning of Spirit's gift. It is supernatural. It is not just the natural discernment. It is not about judging someone. It is not about suspecting someone with doubt. That is not the gift of the Holy Spirit. The gift of the Holy Spirit is about the discerning of the different spirits that are out there in the unseen world. Hallelujah. Let us close our eyes and believe, hallelujah, that God has called us to live an eternal life. An eternal life is to know the true God. Hallelujah. And as we are living in this eternal life, as we are leading this eternal life, there would be many, many situations, maybe fearful situations, where we will be running like Elijah, where we'll be assuming something, you know, speculating something that, no, we are in a very fearful situation. There God will give us that word of knowledge. He will send His good angels, hallelujah, to minister unto us. We have to discern it, hallelujah. We have to discern the Holy Spirit. We have to discern the good angels in our life. We have to discern the different human spirits out there, hallelujah. There are various, hallelujah, human spirits out there that are teaching false doctrines. Hallelujah, let us come back to that, hallelujah. In 1 Timothy chapter 4 we see, hallelujah. In 1 John chapter 4 we see that there are various false teachers, you know, demonic miracle workers, hallelujah. We should know how to discern what is right, hallelujah. What is the right human spirit? What is the right spirit out there? Hallelujah. And which is the evil spirit? Which is the spirit not from God? Hallelujah. Father, Lord, we come before you, Jesus. Lord, thank you for your word that has revealed to us the mysteries of your kingdom, Father. Lord, we believe, hallelujah, that these 9 supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit are for us as a church to build up, hallelujah, to edify each other and to bring common good and to be profit to all, Lord Jesus. And we looked into the first 3 revelation gifts of the Holy Spirit, Lord Father. Lord, help us to, Lord Father, know that these gifts are for us, hallelujah. Help us to desire for it, desire for a word of knowledge, desire for a word of wisdom, desire for the discerning of the Spirit's gift, Father, so that we can lead a victorious Christian life, so that we may not be tossed in the ocean, hallelujah, where there are various false doctrines around, false teachings around, hallelujah, where there are human philosophies that are, Lord, being spread all over us, hallelujah. Help us to discern what is right. Give us the discerning of the Spirit's gift, Lord, hallelujah. Reveal to us your purposes, Lord, hallelujah. Thank you for, Father, blessing us with your word. Lord, I pray for all the people who have heard this, Lord. This word has gone as a seed. Let this seed bring fruit in the life, Father. Earlier we heard the children sing, Lord, Father, that the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Hallelujah. Lord, as we operate in these gifts of the Holy Spirit, well, let us, Lord, be a fruit of the Holy Spirit as well, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Father, thank you, Lord Father, for blessing us with your love, blessing us with your joy and peace and patience, Lord Father. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, oh Lord Father, we are thankful, Lord. Lord, give us your gentleness, oh Lord, and also give us the self-control, Lord, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father, hallelujah, continue to talk to us through your word. Lord, let this week be a blessed week for us, Lord Jesus, so that we can know where we have to manifest these gifts in our life, Father. Lord, help us to know when these gifts are flowing through us, Lord Jesus. Help us to recognize it, Lord. As a church, we are a family, Lord Father. Lord, we are a family of Lord Jesus, hallelujah. We are the member of the body of Jesus Christ, hallelujah. Let every member be fruitful. Let every member be blessed, hallelujah. Let every member be having a desire, Lord. Let every disciple, Lord Father, continue in the word of the God, in the teaching, in the studying of the word, Lord Father. Help us to be the doer of the word, not just the hearer of the word, Lord Father, because there is power in action, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for all your mercies and grace, Lord Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.